43 of House of Experts here from reachiv.com. Super excited to have Isha Amin in the house. Isha, as a lot of you already know, is a celebrity stylist, best known for her personal work with many celebrities, some of which include Karisma Kapoor, Saif Ali Khan, Bipasha Basu, the list goes on. Isha also styles editorial covers. So she's done the cover for Forbes, Filmfare, Femina, and many, many more magazines. She also does campaigns. One of her most famous ones was the one with Amitabh Bachchan for Cry. And she's going to talk a little bit about that so we can learn a little bit from her on that. And she also does many other styling assignments. So she did the, she's also the on the Femina Miss India styling jury, I think it's called. But a little bit more about that from Isha herself. So Isha, welcome to the show.
Hi. Pleasure being here.
All right, let's kickstart the show with my favorite question. So as you know, Isha, we run an education and careers advisory. So I always believe education begins at home. So what was your childhood like? What were your early years like? And, you know, what was that early education like for you?
Well, I grew up in Bombay. I was always interested in art and design, and there was fashion design was not literally anything that I existed. So I would keep like sketching, you know, and I would keep sketching. I would keep creating things. I was a very, a child who always kind of was onto something, you know, like creating something, like doing some sort of craft, some activity, you know, something or the other. So that's when my mother one day saw a lot of my sketches. She said that, you know what, why are you only sketching girls and, you know, clothes? And, you know, there is something called fashion design. So that's when I heard that the first time. I think I was about 8 years old. Oh, and, you know, kind of registered in my mind that this is something that I want to do. And
so very early on, huh? When By that age, you were already sketching and you were into fashion.
Yes, I was not into fashion. Like I said, you know, I didn't know what fashion was. All I knew is that I loved drawing. So all I would keep asking my mother to do is keep sending me to some drawing classes, some craft classes. So I just loved anything about art. So that was me. And only when she kind of saw a lot of my, things that I was doing, I kept kind of, you know, I mean, girls obviously end up dressing up dolls. And, you know, apart from that, I kept sketching a lot of girls and clothes and anything that I would see a magazine cover in front of me, I start replicating, you know, like I start duplicating that. And so I kind of was always sketching, you know. Okay. So that, you know, kind of registered that, you know, that there is something called fashion design and that, oh, I want to grow up and be that. So that's when it all started.
That's how it started. Okay. I have a comment here from Shalini Goenka who says, sounds so much like my 8-year-old. Okay, great. Good to hear that. Early inclination towards following on Isha's steps, I guess, for your daughter there. All right. So what happened next? How was school for you? You know, were you academic in school or were you sort of hinging towards the creative side of school?
I was good at a couple of subjects. I was terrible at maths. I was really good at history, geography. I mean, of course, anything to do with my art classes were always excellent. I did all those typical, exams that you do while you're in school, drawing exams, your elementary, you know, multiple other things. I was always a child who was a lot interested in a lot of, cultural activities in the school. So a lot of dance classes, singing classes, and, you know, multiple other things. So I was always someone who was a very active child, you know. So so these, the subjects that I really loved were history, geography, and so I see where that comes from today, right? Like I love, even today, I love visiting a place and I want to know more about the history, culture, art, you know, royalty, and you know, lived here, what did they wear back then, what are they wearing now, what's the local place like. So I see where my love for history comes down, trickles down to today.
So, okay. Clearly, you're still sort of borrowing elements from those history classes today, even in your career. Tell me, so how did fashion, you know, designing as a subject happen for you? Was it preordained at a very early age that you'd study this?
Yeah, so when I was in my 12th grade, I gave the entrance exam for NIFT. NIFT typically has a specialized exam that you have to give, which is all over India, and then they, you know, have like centralized seating and stuff. So I was for NIFT while I was in my 12th grade, and it does take a couple of months before the results come in, because back then I remember it was a much longer process than what it is today. They had like the first entrance exam, which is your, you know, like basically like any other SAT exam, and then they have a creative ability test where you're sketching and creating something 3D, and then they had like you know, then they had another round, which is a group discussion where you're debating something, sure, forthcoming are you, and then they had something called as a personal interview, which is a much later stage. They shortlist people. So the NIFT entrance kind of was a little longer, you know, and at the same time you know, you always keep your options open. So I did kind of go and you know, apply to a couple of other colleges, and in fact, I won a scholarship also with one of the colleges. I think it was Wigan and Lee, and they, you know,
right,
won a scholarship with them, wherein I could get free education. And I remember fighting with my parents that, listen, I've won myself a scholarship, so why don't you let me go do it? And they were very, and thank God for that, they were very adamant that no, NIFT is the best in the country.
Of course, yeah.
Wait for NIFT results to come out. You are not going and, you know, committing to some scholarship that you've got and stuff. So I remember, you know, they were a little particular that I only study fashion at NIFT. And how NIFT happened, and it was 4 years.
Did their prophecy sort of live out? Do you really think it was sort of one of the premier institutes in the country for fashion?
And I still do believe it is one of the premier institutes in fashion in India, because the kind of in-depth knowledge that they teach you, I mean, at least what they taught us back then, is something I still feel keeps helping me time and again in my career. I mean, it was 4 years of bachelor's of design in fashion and apparel design. That's what I studied. I did not study styling. So sure, that's again another story. Styling is something that I never thought I would do. So
you thought you would be a fashion designer. Is that what you were thinking?
I studied to be a fashion designer for 4 years. I did my, I did all my internships in college only in design. I interned with, you know, while I was in college, I was interning with Provo, which is menswear, you know, a couple of other internships here and there. And I remember then I had, you know, in campus placements, I got picked up by, you know, Mandhana, which is one of the top export houses, European
export.
In India. So I remember, much before I graduated, I already had a job as a women's designer there. And that was my first job. And I did work as a designer there for 3.5 years. That was fine.
What's the turning point then? When do you go from like fashion design to styling? What happens? What is that?
There's a big story there. So basically, when I was designing at Mandhana, which is, you know, for 3.5 years, I in that tenure I got to travel quite a bit, you know. So we would often travel to Europe, various parts of France, Germany, Madrid and stuff, to make presentations to these brands who were I don't know if you know that a lot of international brands outsource their manufacturing and, you know, India. So we would make collections and go there and present it to them. So while during one of the trips is when I realized that, you know, I would just keep kind of admiring all these people on the street. I would keep admiring the VM windows of these stores, and they're all so well put together. None of them are dramatic, none of them are costumey. They were just real fashion, practical fashion, just well styled, you know what I mean? And that's when it struck me that I really enjoy this, you know, like I love dressed people. And it doesn't have to be one crazily designed, innovatively designed, unique piece of clothing. It has to be a unique entire look that's this. You know, a jacket from Zara with like, you know, shoes from Dolce & Gabbana. And, you know, like it can be a whole mix of different brands coming, but it's just creating a cool look. And I felt like the entire, people walking on the street in all these places, Milan and in Paris, they just look like a runway. They're all so well styled. And that's when I kind of decided that I want to give styling a shot. So it was a very short-term plan that, okay, let me just go try this out and see where it, you know, if I like it or not.
So was it at that point a defined career? You know, was it something that you knew people who that did styling as a profession?
My parents thought I was mad because I already had years of job where I was a senior stylist somewhere and I was getting a handsome salary, and then I want to jump to being an intern to a stylist and start from the scratch, because that was the only way. I mean, that was the only way I could make an entry or crack into that world of styling. So I chose to keep aside that package that I had and made this serious shift of just taking up an internship and doing something that I thought, you know, and I had a little intuition that I love more than what I'm doing right now. And that worked.
It worked out. Okay, great. So how was the internship? What did you pick up from the internship?
Well, what I learned, and I keep saying that even today, with styling, you have to be, I mean, with, you know, celebrity styling or anything, I know it all looks glamorous out there that, oh, you know, you're working with so-and-so actor today, or you're with Krishna Kapoor. You know, it just kind of looks very glamorous, but behind the scenes, there is a whole lot of work and assist. Have a lot of the dark, you know, how do you say, like, you know, the odd jobs of picking up bags, you have to be the pukuli, or, you know, picking up pins from somewhere, you're packing, cleaning someone's shoe, you're doing all of that. And you have to be extremely humble and down to earth to be doing that, because you never know, while you're doing that, you're shadowing your senior stylist, you know, to these jobs. You're not the boss of the show. It's not as glamorous as it looks that, oh, I'm going to go there and tell so-and-so actor that this is what you wear. You're actually sitting there and doing unpacking, packing, labeling, ironing, you know, you're doing all of that. But that's when you kind of, you know, observe.
Right.
And you learn the tricks of the trade. And so I made that shift, somewhere 4 years down the career that I'd already started. And so I think to kind of make it work is to be absolutely humble and be open to doing all sorts of odd jobs while
you work. Okay. So the humility and just sort of rolling up your sleeve and saying, I'm just going to do whatever this requires. Okay, guys, yeah. I see your questions in the chat. I'm going to take them one at a time. How did you break into this field as an independent sort of practitioner, right? Who was like your first client, and how did you win that first mandate? Because first time's always special. So how did it happen for you?
So initially when I started off, after a lot of different internships, when I started off as an independent stylist, I started doing only fashion shoots and runways. I did not ever imagine that I would get into celebrity styling, but my first celebrity client was Sania Mirza for, I still remember it was JFW Awards 2012. And so that was my first red carpet that I ever styled. And, from there on, I remember my first ad was Saif Ali Khan for Amul Matchaminas. Don't ask me what I would style in a minute. A lot of technical details, but then it was all about learning. So those were my first two big gigs, and then on it was just word of mouth, one client to another. I started working with Madhuri Dixit, I remember Alia Bhatt, Krishna Kapoor, who still I work with after 8 years.
Okay, so the first, very first was Sania Mirza.
That's right. Okay.
Very first Sania Mirza. Okay, let's take up one or two of these questions. So I have a question here from Uff Mirchi, who says, Isha, is there any standard rules for your line of work and how do those apply? So sort of protocols.
Well, there are no rules. At the end of the day, you just have to be disciplined and focused on what you do. And every client, you have to be sensitive to a client's demand, right? Match up to it, deliver that. These are like that.
Okay, Ufo Mirchi, I hope that answered your question. I'm seeing some more in the flow. Shalini Goenka asking, what was the most difficult change from being an export house designer to a personal stylist? Mm-hmm. Okay, what was it, the transition, and what did it, you know, what did you have to change about yourself as you went sort of solo?
Well, I don't think there was much for me to change. I was just open to learning, you know, learning and up any challenge that came my way. And I don't think that I'm stepping into a new industry, which I don't have a formal in, but of course I've learned fashion and I do know the basics, and now I'm open to learning.
It seems like, you know, just this mentality of very open-minded, open to learning, open to doing whatever the job calls for. It just seems like it's like an attitude.
That's right. You just have to be absolutely open to learning whatever comes your way, you know, like keep exploring it, because until you don't take it up, until you don't do a certain thing, you wouldn't know whether you like it or don't like it. Or
sure.
It is your, you know, genre of styling or, you know, whatever.
Or
you wouldn't know it.
Okay. Thank you for that. Let's, Shalini, I hope that answered your question. Vasudevan Brinda asking, do you know how to sew if you want to become a fashion designer? And can you become a fashion designer if you only know how to stitch? Okay.
I would say that, you know, there are a lot of fashion designers who out there who do not know how to stitch. And, you know, so I think if you know how it's constructed, it's important to learn the basics. Like I studied, you know, sewing and all of that in college, knitting and sewing and everything. But today in the practical world, I don't use that. But yes, it is. I don't do it myself, but I definitely, having that knowledge, I can always guide, a tailor when I'm telling him how I want it done and how to do it and what kind of a pattern will help you. It is important to have that knowledge, but that is not the only thing that helps you become a designer. Just because you know how to sew, meaning, you know, a tailor knows how to sew.
Sure.
So you need to have an eye for fashion, style, you know, you need to have a passion for design. And I think all of that put together, and the knowledge of technicality and how things work, construction and garment construction, all of that put together. Defines a designer.
Okay, great. Thank you for that. Brinda, I hope that answered your question. Gonna go back to my script of questions now. Thanks guys for the questions, and please keep them going in the chat. So tell me, how would you define fashion? Like, what, you know, there's so many definitions out there, right? So what is Isha Amin's definition of fashion?
But I think that's elegant, effortless, and spontaneous. I think that's more my style, where things just look, you've just kind of not tried too hard. It's just style and effortless.
Elegant and effortless. Okay, so you're saying it shouldn't look like you've tried too hard, huh? Because a lot of the celebrities are just like, dude, how much time did you spend coming up with this look?
Well, you know, they do put in an effort, but in that also there is a way, you know, the way they carry it, it depends on how confidently and you carry it and how comfortable you are and what you wear. That's what makes it effortless. It's not how, you know, how light is your garment or how heavy is your garment. You know, a trail down and still look very effortless because you're comfortable and confident, right? So that, for me, is what defines effortless, not wearing a simple garment.
Okay, I like that. I like that explanation. And I think it's very applicable to all of us, not just for the celebrities. Just make whatever your look is effortless, and that's what works. Okay, I like that. I think it's so true. I mean, you know, you look at someone who's comfortable in their skin and their clothing, and automatically that's already a wow reaction. You know, I like that answer. Thank you. Tell me some of the pitfalls of this. You know, what are some of the challenges you had with working with these celebrities? And we don't need to name anyone, but just experiences you've had with a celebrity. You know, have there been cases where you've recommended an outfit and celebrity says, no, I'm not going to do this color or this style? Or are they, by and large, are they compliant because you're the expert?
Well, you know, Bollywood to me was unknown. So I kind of entered with a clean slate, which I think has helped me. I'm really fortunate that the industry kind of warmed up to me and accepted my work. And it's been a vast experience. So there is, I mean, there's a lot that I've learned from here. And each client, each actor is different. Each one has their own personality, and I wouldn't say there is anything wrong in it. But however, as a stylist, if they insist on wearing something that I feel is not working for them, I do advise them on something better. But you know, I do advise them on something better. But how do you say that? I would put it in a way which makes it, you know, very easy for them to understand. And I may have to pull them out of their comfort zone, but they still feel confident about taking that advice. And I think that's a part of styling, is also to be able to sell your ideas and to convince your client. So I, there are clients who have their own style, their personality. They do come with set thing about what they want, but then when you're working on something together, you might just come across something better, and it is up to you to kind of you know, make that happen for them.
Okay, so that's obviously a big part of the role, right? Just building that trust with your client.
Right.
Okay, and you know, how does the business work? Like, how do you source, you know, the things they're going to wear, the accessories, the garments, all of that? Like, how do you even build a sort of supply chain, so to speak, in this career?
Well, there's a whole lot of research that we do. You know, every day is not a shoot day. Every day you're not shooting. So there are days when I'm we're only sitting and researching, looking up. You know, me and my team are only looking up at runways, various brand collections, what have they launched, what are the new things out there, who's wearing what. Is a part of celebrity styling. A very important part is that, you know, the pieces have to not only work for your client and their body type and their personality and, you know, their what, but it also should be something that has never been worn by another celebrity, because otherwise conflict and controversy. So that is a huge responsibility of stylists. So a lot of our time goes into research, and we're interacting with designers and brands, not only in India, but also internationally. So we also work in different time zones for that. You know, people in the US only open up after, you know, it's dinner time here. So we do work in different time zones and do connect with all these designers everywhere and source pieces. So the idea of getting a stylist for a media event is basically when a celebrity collaborates with a brand, right? So we as stylists try and source pieces for them from various designers and brands. And then of course, you know, it's basically a marketing activity wherein we help the designer promote, you know, a new collection, a new product that they've made by giving them a sighting on the design, and then it is kind of, you know, the
is it you sort of more scouting the suppliers, or is the supplier sort of reaching out to you? Which way does the tide flow? It's both ways.
It's both. We have brands reaching out to us all the time. We reach out to people who we discover, and you know, so. But it's all a part of our research.
Okay, all right. So it's a two-way stream. You know, ideas are coming to you. You're going out and scouting ideas, and then, okay, I'm going to take this actually very good question here from Varsha Casey, who says, "How do styling trends start?" Okay, this is a good question. How does a trend start?
Well, you know, runways, typically fashion weeks worldwide, are known to be as, you know, a trendsetter. So fashion forecasts, there are these fashion forecast, you know, websites, which are paid memberships, very exclusive. They really talk about what's going to be the trend 2.5 years time. So it is... you know, very specialized services that a lot of, you know, designers who can afford it, they do it. And these are kind of, they kind of tell you basic, you know, like things like these are going to be the shapes, these are going to be the kind of prints, this is where the world is going. And, you know, then your another avenue is your runway. That's where you take a look at, you know, what runway designers all over the world are doing. So then you kind of spot a similarity in things that, you know, a bunch of them are doing, and that's when you know that, okay, metallics are in, okay, florals are in, you know, androgyny is in. So, you know, you kind of figure with what is going around on the runway, and then you do evaluate whether a certain trend is versatile, meaning it can, you know, it can be, you know, like maybe a cold shoulder, it can be done with a dress, a top, a skirt, a... You know, you see how versatile a certain trend is, and that's when you know the trend is going to last long, or it's something that, you know, cannot be worn for more than, you know, it can't be really worn for too long beyond a season or two, and it's going to fade away. So that kind of gives us that indication.
Okay, wow. Varsha, I hope you got the answer. It seems like the trend's emerging from forecasting agencies who are professionally, sort of, this is what they do, they forecast trends. And then the runway sort of attests to that trend when you see it sort of pan out in fashion. Okay, this is great, Isha. I didn't know a lot of this stuff. So thank you for sharing a slice of your everyday life. Going to take a question here. Suchna Parmanik, who says, is styling in India different from styling abroad? Is there a difference?
Well, yes and no. You know, each place has their own... how do you say, has its own, you know, charm. Like, in of course, in India, we work with a lot of Indian wear, you know. Sure. You know, we have events where our celebrities want to wear, and Indian weddings are a huge, how do you say, are an avenue where people use stylists the most.
Right? Sure, of course.
That's a big part of the Indian styling industry. Of course, we do have looks, we have our casual looks, we have our promotion looks, we have airport looks today. We have a whole lot that we do otherwise, you know, personal shopping, wardrobe management, etc. But yeah, the only, I think what sets us apart from styling internationally is that we have a whole lot of Bollywood actors to cater to, and Indian wear is something that's very unique only to Bollywood.
Okay. Bollywood and the Indian component. Okay, thank you. Since you brought up you know, the celebrities, are you also accessible to, you know, sort of the common person? Like, do you have
Yes.
regular clients as well?
Yes. So we do have. I do have a company called the Style Elevator, which is basically a wardrobe management and a wedding styling company. So we work with a lot of business families across the country and NRIs who, you know, either want, you know, a special occasion styling for a wedding in the family, or they're the bride or the groom, or there are clients who, you know, shuffle between India and abroad and constantly want a wardrobe makeover every season. We have a bunch of corporate clients who work with us on a wardrobe makeover every season. So there are people who also use our services on a daily basis. That is, their weekly wardrobes, Monday to Saturday, is planned by us from what's within their wardrobes. We pick and choose and style looks for them. And that is something that we do. If
Okay, so you do that.
That's right.
Okay. And what did you say? What's the best way to reach you for that? I'll just put it out there as well.
You could either email us at ishaameen@gmail.com or thestyleelevator@gmail.com or on Instagram. We do work a lot. We do have a lot of people reaching out to us on Instagram, which is either on my page, which is ishaameen1 or at thestyleelevator.
Okay.
That's right. Yeah, so these are the two avenues that you could reach us at.
Okay, guys, you heard that. The Style Elevator is the website and the Instagram handle. And she is accessible to the just everyday people who are looking to enhance their wardrobe and their everyday look. Harshita Duggar asking here, do you make collaborations with new labels in celebrity styling? If yes, how do we reach you? How do people reach you for collabs?
Well, same thing. Reaching out is either Instagram or email, both of which are there on my page. We're always scouting for new brands, new good brands. So yes, if it is something that really works with what we're looking for, we're happy to collaborate.
Okay, I hope that helped, Harshita, and as well as Kam Karm. You've been asking many questions here. Demi, when you look at someone, right? Like, let's say you get a new client.
Right.
If I don your celebrity glasses, what do you look at? You know, what do you look at in a very objective fashion? And it's okay if you be sort of objective, but what does one look at as a stylist? Where do your eyes go? You know, do they look at the person's frame first? Do you look at my face first? Like, how do you dissect someone?
Well, you know, don't judge me on this, but of course, when I meet someone for the first time, I do look at how well have they, you know, of course, how well have they dressed. I'm not somebody who would say that, oh, you know, you're wearing something which is last season, old season or whatever.
Sure.
As well as, you know, you could be in a simple white shirt and a pair of denims or, you know, a classic black suit. It doesn't matter as long as it is, you know, it's stylish, well put together. You're wearing the right kind of shoes which complement it. You're well groomed. You have, you know, you're wearing the right kind of belt, watch, whatever. So it just has to be. You know, you could be in the simplest of outfit, but as long as it is put together very well in a very classy way and you're just stylish. I think that works for me instantly. And then of course, comes, but I think that's for anyone, right? When you see somebody, your first impression about that person is the way the person looks.
Be
heavy, thin, fat, whatever he or she. You would always look at, oh, you know what? I like the way, I like what I'm seeing there. I like how well-dressed this person is. And then, of course, comes making a conversation. So I think that first impression, you know, as a fashion director to Miss India organization, I always tell the girls that they need to stand out because your first entry when you're representing India internationally is you're standing with like Miss Venezuela, you know, like all these other different countries. When you stand out there, we want you to stand out,
sure.
You know, and
of course.
And
the way you dress obviously is the first thing someone would notice.
Yourself makes a huge difference in making you stand out from the rest. If you had to pick 10 people in a room with 100 people, you would obviously pick the ones who catch your attention. And dressing up is a major part of that.
Okay. But let's say I came to you as a client, right? Like when you meet a client for the first time, how do you know what's going to work on this client, right? Is it a factor of the personality? Is it the body type? And even the body type also, how do you know? Like, how do you do this job?
Well,
the job?
There are a couple of things. Well, I look at the person. I do understand whether, you know, based on their body type, their skin tone, their lifestyle, where do they work? Where do they live? What do they do? What are their weekends like? You know, do they play tennis? Do they play golf? So I like to know all of that. So when I first meet a person, the first thing that you would kind of assume is, okay, body type, this, that doesn't work for you. And then comes an in-depth analysis of understanding whether, you know, where does he live? What does he do? Is she a mother of two? Where, you know, what's her daily life like? What's her weekend like? What's her social life like? Where does she work? Does she wear pantsuits to work? Does she wear Indian wear to work? What is, you know, then comes an in-depth analysis of what the person is all about and where now can I enhance her style and put together better things for her than what she's tried up until now.
Ah, okay. So you would think of it from that perspective. Like, what can I do now that she's not tried so far as well?
That's always what I think about. That what can I give you new that you haven't tried before and something that excites you to, you know, love yourself more when you, you know, it's I feel like dressing up is also something which is, you know, which brings out a lot of confidence in somebody. When you look good, you feel good, you know, you feel great and confident about it. So I think dressing up well is a boost of confidence. You know, why do you tell your students that, okay, when you're going for an interview, wear a suit, wear a tie, dress in a certain way? Because it does make an impact. So, you know, why not tell them that also learn a certain pattern of corporate dressing, right? Like, you know, what do tan shoes go with? What do, black shoes go with? Okay. Is black the only color for your suit, or you can do grays and beige? And, you know, can women also do powder pastels and pink and mint? And, you know, is that color that's accepted? So how, you know, what's my body type like? Will checks work for me? Will broad stripes work for me? Do I do only pinstripes? So there is a lot that one can do if they understand what works for them and what doesn't.
Okay. So, okay. Wow. This sounds like super detailed and super analytical and obviously factoring in many components. Guys, I have to close this soon. I'm just going to take the last few questions. Ayushi Modi asking here, do you collaborate with wedding planners? Have you collaborated with wedding planners?
A lot of wedding planners approach us for styling their clients, for weddings that they are planning. And we do work with a lot of wedding planners on wedding styling for the bride,
okay,
groom.
Ayushi. They do for the groom, bride, maybe the entire family. So do get in touch with Isha. That's of interest. Harshita Dugar, what is the future of a fashion stylist as a career? Okay, what does the future look like? Isha, I mean, what does your future look like if you had to roll?
Well, in my future or in general, what is the future of a fashion stylist?
Where do you see this career going?
Well, I feel like styling in general is just going, it's just becoming wider as a career. Okay, back in the day, we probably only had costume designers doing films, and we didn't really have paparazzi, so we didn't have airport looks. We didn't have people doing so many promotional events. But right now, with social media in place, paparazzi being everywhere. Right from outside airports to outside restaurants to outside celebrity homes, there is a huge scope of styling. You could be a personal stylist, you could be a stylist to films, you could be working with a magazine, you could be working for theater or dance reality shows. There are a whole lot of that out there. So, or you could be a personal shopper or a wardrobe management kind of a company. Or for image consultancy kind of a firm. So there is a whole lot that you can do with styling. It's not just limited. Or you could get into pageantry and be like a beauty pageant expert. So there is a lot in the career of a stylist. It's expanding.
Right. Okay. So you're saying that the definition is just sort of expansive and more things are coming under the purview of styling. Okay, great. Thank you for that. Shalini Goenka saying here, I would like you to please address a forum with a large number of women. We'll invite you to Bangalore. Okay, great, Shalini Goenka, you know how to teach. Isha through Instagram, through Gmail. Okay, let's take the last two questions, guys. Cash Gupta, how can a fresher who wants to be a future stylist start their career? And some of the qualities. But, guys, you already talked about the qualities.
Yeah.
I'm just going to request you to talk about the starting the career.
Well, I see that I would say just, take some amount of formal education in design. Doesn't have to be in styling. Just understand fashion, learn something about fashion, take a formal course, even if it's a short term course, and then kind of do internships and learn from people, because styling is an on the field job. So it's not something that you can learn in the books.
Okay, so pick up some hard skills and then go refine them in the real world.
That's right.
How is a budget, how is a budget set in personal, commercial and editorial styling? Okay, how do you work with monies? How do you allocate budgetary?
So honestly, it's different for different projects. It only depends on what is, what's the project all about. Honestly, there is no set budget that we have. Totally depends on what is the project.
Depends on a case to case basis. Isha, question from my mom, Kahira Kags. Have you declined any category?
Hey, I lost you.
So, can you hear me now?
Yes, I can. Tell me.
Okay. I have a question from my mom, Hira Kagzi, right here, who's asking, wow, do you style women 65 years and older? Have you styled anyone in that age category?
I do. I have a lot of clients who are 65 plus, and they invest very, very well on their personal styling and day-to-day styling. They, look after CSR activities for their husband's company. They have a social life, so they all take care of what they wear and how they want to revamp everything that they have in their wardrobe. Doesn't have to be go out shopping every time you have to step out. You just have to know how to make use of a whole lot of things that you have there or there. So, which is what we do with wardrobe makeovers every season for clients, every month, put together their looks for the month, for 3 months, whatever.
Okay, you might get a phone call very soon. last question as we're sort of tuning out. For the people not in the know-how, right? What are some of the current fashion trends that we should all be aware of? What are some of the do's and don'ts right now?
Very, very vast topic. That is not something that you can tune in and out. So anyways, a couple of things that really is like the thing of the season is one, stocking up on a lot of basics. So like, a black dress, a white shirt, denims, a black blazer, black shoes, tan shoes, sunglasses that work for your face frame. So stacking up on basics and then learning how to mix and match them in multiple ways and keep restyling them. So have your basics right. I think that is the need, but also because of the whole pandemic, people have kind of revisited a lot of their wardrobes and pulled out things that they haven't worn for a long time and have figured how to make it, which was old, they've kind of made it to what's new and, this season. So I think getting, stocking your wardrobe with basics is a great idea to start with.
Okay, thank you so much. Stock your wardrobe with basics, the denims, the white shirt, the black dress, all the classics. Also, I definitely want to throw out a personal compliment to you, Isha. I follow you on Instagram, and some of the pictures you post, and I mean, the word you used, effortless, you really make this super stylish wardrobe look completely effortless. Your recent pictures in Jaipur or in Rajasthan, wherever you were, and some of the outfits were just mind-blowing, and obviously you carry them off. You just make the outfit look 10 times as, probably even the designer hadn't fathomed that it would end up looking so fabulous. So,
thank you.
Not only do you have a terrific, design sense, you're also able to just make the outfits look absolutely stunning. Of course, your wedding wardrobe must look fab.
That each one can, if they know what works for them, that is something that they can. It's just about finding out what your body requires.
Absolutely. And thanks to this conversation, I'm sure you've left a lot of us with some confidence saying, it's that there is a light at the end of the tunnel, and we will get in touch with you. But Isha, thank you so much. Thanks for being candid. Thank you for sharing so many personal experiences. Great learning. And thanks again. Thanks for everyone.
Bye.
Bye. Thank you. All right, guys, that was Isha Amin sharing some of her insider wardrobe secrets. Thank you all for tuning in. Thank you all for those questions. And tune for House of Experts, episode 44 coming up soon. If you have a certain celebrity or a career that you would like to learn more about, definitely write to me at Vibha Kagzi or Ping Reach IV. And until then, have a great evening and stay stylish and stay effortlessly stylish. All right, have a great one. Thank you, guys. I'm going to sign off now.